Hello and a very good morning. You're watching the Breakfast News on Rajya Sabha Television and I'm Frank Pereira. Let's begin with the headlines. Suspense continues over government formation in Jammu and Kashmir as Mehbooba Mufti sets conditions for the BJP, asks alliance partner to set time frame for implementing agenda of alliance for the state. Protests for quota by Kapu community in Andhra Pradesh turns violent. 15 policemen injured in attack on police vehicles and train. Chief Minister assures he is committed to promise of reservation. Vice President Mohammad Hamid Ansari to take forward India's Act East policy to begin 5-day official tour of Brunei and Thailand today. At least 71 killed in bombings claimed by the Islamic State near a Shiite shrine outside Damascus attack even as UN-sponsored peace talks attempt to break deadlock in Geneva. And India becomes the number one side again in the ICC T20 rankings after bagging the three-match series against Australia with a win in Sydney. Our top focus on the bulletin this Monday morning. It's been more than 3 weeks since the demise of Jammu and Kashmir Chief Minister Mufti Mohammad Saeed, but uncertainty over government formation in the state continues. The PDP seems to be in no hurry to form the government in the state in alliance with the BJP. And to make matters worse for the Saffron Party, the PDP has now spelled out its condition for government formation in Jammu and Kashmir and time-bound following of the agenda of alliance. Here's a detailed report.
Hardening its stance over government formation in Jammu and Kashmir, the PDP has sought clear and definite assurances on tricky issues from alliance partner the BJP. Party President Mehbooba Mufti presided over a four-hour-long meeting with party leaders on Sunday, wherein it was decided that a decision on government formation will be taken only after the party is convinced by the BJP on implementing the agenda of alliance.
Mehbooba Mufti will take a call, surely, on the basis of the agenda of alliance. Once she is convinced and the party is convinced that the trust reposed by us in the entire country through that document is reciprocated.
For the first time since the death of her father, Mufti Mohammad Saeed, Mehbooba Mufti broke her silence, spelling out her condition for government formation in Jammu and Kashmir. In the meeting on Sunday, Mufti is learned to have expressed displeasure over the little movement forward on implementation of political and economic initiatives by the centre, despite her father taking the courageous, although unpopular, decision of aligning with the BJP. She also told party workers that the purpose of the alliance was not limited to government formation, but to take Jammu and Kashmir out of trouble that it was faced for most part of its history. The party's stand further pushed the state into uncertainty as it has been under governor's rule since the death of former Chief Minister Mufti Mohammad Saeed on January 7. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
While taking forward India's Act East policy, Vice President Mohammad Hamid Ansari is embarking on a 5-day official visit to Brunei and Thailand today. The goal is not only to increase two-way investment opportunities with both the important South Asian nations, but also to create a convergence of views and increase political cooperation on regional and global issues. Here's a report.
Vice President Mohammad Hamid Ansari will be in Brunei Darussalam between 1st and 3rd of February. In Darussalam, the Vice President will meet Haji Al-Muhtadi Billah, the Crown Prince Haji Hasan Al-Bolkiah, the Sultan of Brunei. He will also address the Indian community.
We'll discuss a number of issues of bilateral, regional and multilateral significance and also hold discussions on cooperation in sectors such as civil aviation, space, trade and investment, besides hydrocarbons, information and communication, etc. A couple of MOUs that we are expected to sign are related to the field of health and defense cooperation.
The Vice President will also visit Thailand from 3rd to 5th of February. In capital Bangkok, He will meet Prime Minister, General Prayut Chan-o-cha and also have an audience with Princess Mahachakri Sirindhon, who is a scholar in Sanskrit language.
We have an expanding relationship in the field of security cooperation in defense, education and science and technology and people-to-people contacts. In 2015, more than 1 million Indian tourists visited Thailand and over 100,000 Thai tourists visited India. This is a growing area of cooperation. So we look forward to discussions on various issues pertaining to our relationship.
The Vice President's visit is important in the face of diversifying India's hydrocarbon needs and strategic goals. It's also important in the matter of anti-terror collaboration and checking organized crime like drug trafficking. Akhilesh Suman's report for Rajya Sabha TV.
Well, Prime Minister Narendra Modi addressed the nation on Sunday in the 16th edition of his monthly radio program, Mann Ki Baat. It was also his first radio address in the new year, wherein the Prime Minister spoke at length on issues ranging from farmers' security to saving the girl child, promoting khadi to the success of initiatives like the Startup India Venture. Since his address came a day after the death anniversary of Mahatma Gandhi, the Prime Minister also paid tribute to the father of the nation and dedicated his speech to the martyrs. Let's listen in.
In his first radio address of 2016, Prime Minister Narendra Modi highlighted the crop insurance scheme launched by his government. He said there is need to spread awareness about the Pradhan Mantri crop insurance scheme launched earlier this month, terming it a New Year's gift for farmers. Modi expressed hope that in the next 2 years, at least 50% of the farmers would avail the scheme.
2016 भारत सरकार ने एक बहुत बड़ा तोहफा किसानों को दिया है प्रधानमंत्री फसल बीमा योजना लेकिन ये योजना की तारीफ हो वाहवाही हो प्रधानमंत्री को बधाइयां मिले इसके लिए नहीं है इतने सालों से फसल बीमा की चर्चा हो रही है लेकिन देश के 20-25% से ज्यादा किसान उसके लाभार्थी नहीं बन पाए हैं उसके जुड़ नहीं पाए हैं क्या हम संकल्प कर सकते हैं कि आने वाले एक दो साल में हम कम से कम देश के 50% किसानों को फसल बीमा से जोड़ सके बस मुझे इसमें आपकी मदद चाहिए
He also lauded the country's youth for turning Startup India into a reality by embracing the scheme. Through his address, he sought to quell the misconception that the initiative is only for the IT sector. He also said he would like to make Startup a nationwide movement like the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan.
जब Startup का कार्यक्रम 16 जनवरी को हुआ, सारे देश के नौजवानों में नई ऊर्जा, नई चेतना, नया उमंग, नया उत्साह मैंने अनुभव किया और लेकिन एक बात जो सामान्य लोगों की सोच है कि स्टार्टअप मतलब कि आईटी रिलेटेड बातें बहुत ही सोफिस्टिकेटेड कारोबार स्टार्टअप के इस इवेंट के बाद ये भ्रम टूट गया आईटी के आसपास का स्टार्टअप तो एक छोटा सा हिस्सा है जीवन विशाल है आवश्यकताएं अनंत है स्टार्टअप भी
In his 30-minute address, the Prime Minister also pitched for continued efforts to spread awareness to save the girl child. He mentioned the success of the Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao campaign in Haryana and credited those behind the initiative for bringing about a real societal change.
सेक्स रेशियो में बहुत गड़बड़ हो चुकी थी 1000 बेटे के सामने जन्म लेने वाली बेटियों की संख्या बहुत कम हो गई थी बड़ी चिंता थी सामाजिक संतुलन खतरे में पड़ गया था और जब मैं हरियाणा पसंद किया तो मुझे हमारे अधिकारियों ने कहा था कि नहीं नहीं साहब वहां मत कीजिए वहां तो बड़ा ही नेगेटिव माहौल है लेकिन मैंने काम किया और मैं आज हरियाणा को हृदय से अभिनंदन करता हूं उन्होंने इस बात को अपनी बात बना ली और आज बेटियों के जन्म की संख्या में बहुत तेजी से वृद्धि हो रही है
The Prime Minister also spoke of promoting khadi in India, stressing on the employment opportunity it can provide to millions of people.
सकारात्मक माहौल बना रहा खादी अब एक सिंबल बना है एक अलग पहचान बना है अब अब खादी युवा पीढ़ी के भी आकर्षण का केंद्र बनता जा रहा है और खास करके जो जो होलिस्टिक हेल्थ केयर और ऑर्गेनिक की तरफ झुकाव रखते हैं उनके लिए तो एक उत्तम उपाय बन गया है। फैशन के रूप में भी खादी ने अपनी जगह बनाई है और मैं खादी से जुड़े लोगों का अभिनंदन करता हूं कि उन्होंने खादी में नयापन लाने के लिए भरपूर प्रयास किया है। मोबाइल फोन पर भी
He also used his radio address to plug the international fleet review scheduled to start on the 5th of February in Vishakhapatnam.
सिर्फ इतना ही करना है, बस इंस्टॉल कर दीजिए अपने मोबाइल फोन से।
Well, shifting focus to some economic news now, the Reserve Bank will announce its sixth bi-monthly monetary policy review on Tuesday before presentation of the union budget amid clamour for rate cut to give a boost to the economy. Experts, however, say that the apex bank may keep the rates unchanged and possibly watch out for the budget for a clear roadmap on key macroeconomic parameters.
As inflation has inched upwards, RBI may keep interest rates unchanged in the upcoming monetary policy review on Tuesday. WPI as well as retail inflation have risen. In December, WPI-based inflation stood at -0.73%, while retail inflation was at 5.61%. Experts say while RBI may maintain status quo, it is likely to adopt an accommodative stance.
I don't feel very optimistic for any further reduction. But the problem is industrial production has gone down. Though it is a month-to-month figure, nevertheless, the call of the time is that it should go up. Any reduction, and more so, this situation having no hope to me for interest rate reduction.
Industrial production plunged to an over four-year low, contracting 3.2% in November, raising expectations of corporate India for a rate cut. However, industry chambers voiced the need for banks to transmit the lower interest rate to borrowers to revive demand and kickstart the investment cycle.
The RBI has cut earlier the interest rates, but that has not been passed on to the consumers. And the banks say that unless the borrowing rates come down, how can they be passing on the benefits to the consumers? The borrowing rates are still very high.
The RBI wants annual inflation at 5% by March 2017, but inflation has been ticking up. The implementation of the 7th Pay Commission, which will raise wages of government employees by nearly 25%, and government's efforts to revise budget deficit targets to stimulate demand may drive inflation further beyond the RBI's target. Kriti Mishra's report for Rajya Sabha TV.
In other news now, there were violent protests in East Godavari district of Andhra Pradesh where the Kapu community was protesting demanding reservation under the backward class category. Train coaches were burnt and police vehicles and station attacked. Meanwhile, Chief Minister Chandrababu Naidu has assured he is committed to reservation to the community. Here's more.
Protests by the Kapu community in Andhra Pradesh turning violent. Thousands of protesters gathered in Tuni town in East Godavari district to demand their inclusion in the list of backward classes. Agitators going on a rampage, setting four coaches of the Ratnachal Express on fire at the Tuni station. They also blocked National Highway 16 in East Godavari district. At least 15 policemen injured in the stir after agitators also damaged police vehicles in the area and set ablaze at least two of them.
While conducting the meeting, one Mudragada Padmanabham is a Kapu leader and is also ex-MP. He provocated the public and several people also present on the dais, all Kapu leaders and all other dignitaries. So they provoked the public and all of them, they came to the railway track and also they observed Rasta Roko, Rail Roko.
The protest forced the authorities to stop all trains running between Vishakhapatnam and Vijayawada stations, causing a huge inconvenience to passengers.
Both lines up and down are blocked. I was told the road is also blocked. People are agitating. No one is injured. They are not harming any passenger, neither the railway staff. But we are not able to move the train. all the tracks, up line and down line, it is blocked.
The leaders of the Kapoor caste, that is an agricultural community, say the state government has failed to keep its promise to include them in the list of backward classes. Reacting to the agitation, Chief Minister Chandrababu Naidu called an emergency meeting and later said he was committed to quota for the community. The assurance, however, cut little ice with the protesters.
This is where we are having a problem. We'll fight it out. We'll convince people. I am requesting everybody. Again and again, I'm requesting. Meeru charcha cheyandi, repati nunchi debate cheyandi. Kapoor reservation sambandhi Teluguesam party is totally committed.
According to the police, the situation was under control and peaceful, and additional forces have been deployed to maintain law and order. The South Central Railway General Manager held a disaster control meeting with the higher officials in Hyderabad. Additional RPF personnel have been deployed to provide security to railway passengers. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
Well, here's a look now at what's expected to make news during the course of the day today in our segment, The Day Ahead. The Press Information Bureau will hold a meeting between cabinet ministers and top editors in Jaipur today and tomorrow. The event will discuss policies in the social sectors and infrastructure development in the country and will strategize, seek views and suggestions from participants on the need for improvement in these sectors. Union ministers Meneka Gandhi, Najma Hepatullah and JP Nadda will be attending the event. Bihar Chief Minister Nitish Kumar is set to resume from today his popular Janta Darbar after a long break to listen to the people's grievances. The Darbar was discontinued last year in view of the model code of conduct for the assembly polls. On the second day of his visit to Punjab, Union Minister of State for Home Affairs Kiran Rijiju will interact with people from border areas of Ajnala near Amritsar. Rijiju visited Jallianwala Bagh and the Golden Temple in Amritsar on Sunday. Well, it's time for a short break now, but news and updates will continue on the other side. Stay tuned. We'll be right back.
To mine or not to mine. Meghalaya is caught in a bitter legal battle.
There can be an alternative for livelihood, but no alternative for environmental damage. What happens when these coal reserves finish?
It's a question of political will, which is pending with Government of India.
At stake is livelihood of millions of people.
किसी खाने को नहीं है किसी छोटे छोटे बच्चे हैं यहाँ पे हमारे बच्चे को एजुकेशन नहीं मिल रहा है
यहाँ तक क्यों लोग आत्महत्या करने के लिए मजबूर हो गए हैं लोग
वॉच आवर स्पेशल रिपोर्ट कर्स ऑफ द ब्लैक गोल्ड ओनली ऑन राज्यसभा टेलीविजन
Welcome back. You're watching Rajya Sabha Television. Well, the Supreme Court will hear the Congress plea against President's rule in Arunachal Pradesh. In its last hearing, the court had issued notices to the centre and the governor on imposition of President's rule. This came after the Congress challenged the cabinet's decision to recommend centre's rule. The fresh plea filed by the chief whip of the Congress legislature party, the party has alleged that illegal and unlawful attempts have been made by the centre and the governor Jyoti Prasad Rajkowar to topple the Nabam Tuki government in the state. The centre, in its affidavit in the Supreme Court last week, said that there was a complete breakdown of law and order in the state and that the governor and his family apprehended grave danger to their lives. The Guwahati High Court is also hearing a writ petition by the Speaker of the Assembly challenging the governor's notification in December last year, advancing the Assembly session.
The Congress, which has ruled and ruined the country for more than 60 years, has no moral right to criticize others. See what is happening. They are criticizing the government decision of imposing president rule in Arunachal Pradesh and call it as a murder of democracy. Congress party has imposed president rule 100 times, more than 100 times. That means, have you committed 100 murders? Let the Congress explain.
ये एफआईआर करके एक चीफ मिनिस्टर को निकाल के एक पार्टी को बदनाम करके अगर वो अपना गवर्नमेंट लाना चाहते हैं तो ये इससे बुरा कोई मार्ग नहीं हो सकता
And while the Congress is likely to convene a meeting of opposition leaders ahead of the budget session of Parliament, the proposed meeting is to ensure coordination among them on the floor of the House to corner the government on various issues. The government is set to take a decision this week on the schedule of the session, which is likely to begin on February 23rd. There has been no such formal consultation among the opposition parties ahead of the Parliament session since the BJP-led NDA came to power 20 months ago. The Pathankot terror strike, imposition of President's rule in Arunachal Pradesh and suicide by a Dalit research scholar at Hyderabad Central University are among the matters on which opposition parties could make a common cause. The budget session comes ahead of assembly elections in 5 states: West Bengal, Assam, Tamil Nadu, Puducherry and Kerala. Well, Nepal's Army Chief General Rajendra Chhetri will begin his 6-day official visit to India from today on the invitation of his Indian counterpart General Dalbir Singh Suhag. As part of the tradition of exchanging titles of honorary generals between Nepal and India, General Chhetri will receive the honorary rank of General of the Indian Army from Indian President Pranab Mukherjee. During his stay in India, General Chhetri, along with his delegation of 9 members, will meet the Indian Army Chief and the Air Force Chief. He is also scheduled to call on the Home Minister, Defence Minister and External Affairs Minister. The Army Chief's visit comes ahead of the proposed visit of Prime Minister K.P. Oli to India in February. However, Oli has expressed reservations about making the India visit amid the border blockade. This will be General Chhetri's first trip abroad since assuming command of the country's military in September last year. Meanwhile, Afghanistan's Chief Executive Officer Abdullah Abdullah arrived in New Delhi on Sunday for a 5-day visit. Abdullah, the head of the Council of Ministers, will hold talks with Prime Minister Narendra Modi and other leaders and also discuss key regional and bilateral issues including security cooperation. Abdullah is scheduled to meet Prime Minister Modi today. The Afghan CEO is also due to attend a conference on counter-terrorism in India's Pink City, Jaipur on Tuesday. India and Afghanistan share a strong relationship. India has played a significant role in the reconstruction and rehabilitation of Afghanistan. According to Indian Foreign Ministry, India's extensive developmental assistance program for Afghanistan now stands at around $2 billion. Well, bombings claimed by the Islamic State killed more than 71 on Sunday near a revered Shiite shrine outside the Syrian capital. It was one of the worst attacks in a government-controlled area of Damascus, serving as another vicious reminder of what is at stake in the Geneva talks, which are yet to produce anything more than statements by the related parties.
Close to 71 killed, dozens injured on Sunday in coordinated bombings near a Shia Muslim shrine in Damascus, with Islamic State claiming responsibility. The first blast was caused by a car bomb, and then 2 suicide bombers blew themselves up near the revered Sayyida Zainab Mosque, leading to burning buildings, a huge crater in the road, and charred and wrecked vehicles. The attack comes at a time when Syrian government and its divided opposition are in Geneva for the first UN-mediated peace talks in 2 years. While Damascus dismisses its opponents as terrorists and insists that 2 anti-Assad rebel groups be barred from talks, the main opposition group insists the government must first meet key humanitarian demands. The UN envoy to Syria has scheduled separate discussions with both sides in Geneva on Monday. The US, Britain, France and Saudi Arabia are working hard to ensure that the talks do go ahead and are supporting the opposition closely.
Those who are imposing on the Syrian people this kind of bloodshed are not Syrians. There are foreign powers endorsing foreign agendas aiming at making political pressure on the Syrian government by using terrorism as a political weapon.
Now, while battlefield dynamics can affect negotiating leverage, in the end, there is no military solution to the conflict. Without negotiations, the bloodshed will drag on.
The United Nations has said that it is aiming for 6 months of talks, first seeking a ceasefire and later working towards a political settlement for Syria. The nearly five-year conflict has killed more than 2,50,000 people, driven more than 10 million from their homes and drawn in global powers. Last time talks were held in Geneva 2 years ago, the Syrian parties exchanged insults and the negotiations broke down without result. Bureau report, Rajya Sabha TV.
And some more international news now. At least 86 people have been killed in an attack by Boko Haram militants near Nigeria's northeastern city of Maiduguri. The extremists firebombed huts and reports say several children were burned to death. Scores of charred corpses and bodies with bullet wounds littered the streets from the attack on the Lori village and two nearby camps housing 25,000 refugees. It was the third attack this week suspected to have been carried out by the insurgent group and the most deadly. Since it started losing control of territory, Boko Haram has reverted to hit-and-run attacks on villages as well as suicide bombings on places of worship or markets. The shooting, burning and explosions from three suicide bombers continued for nearly 4 hours in the unprotected area. The violence continued as three female suicide bombers blew up among people who managed to flee to neighboring Gamori village. Troops arrived at Dalori but were unable to overpower the attackers who were better armed. Well, let's shift focus to some sports news now. India once again became the number one side in the ICC T20 rankings after whitewashing Australia in the three-match series in Sydney. In the third T20, India clashed or rather chased a mammoth target of 197 runs posted by Australia in a last ball thrilling encounter. Virat Kohli was adjudged the man of the series for his spectacular performance in all three matches.
India completed a total whitewash of the three-match T20 series against Australia, defeating the host by 7 wickets in the third and final T20 match in Sydney. Batting first, Australia's stand-in captain Shane Watson smashed an unbeaten 124 as the host scored a commendable 197 for 5 in 20 overs.
Watson running very hard. Ball one here.
Chasing the target, India remained on course for victory with the help of half centuries from Rohit Sharma and Virat Kohli. However, the match went down the wire with the visitors needing 17 off the last over. Suresh Raina hit the winning boundary of the last ball to complete India's whitewash.
Boundary! Suresh Raina gets the winning runs for India. What a run chase that is!
Overall, you know, we never thought that it is something that's beyond a par score, and I feel, you know, we have closed the series really well because we are always lacking that, you know, that one extra step that was needed from the side. You know, we are not able to do that, but in the last three or four games, you know, we can definitely say that we have done it. You know, as a team, we have done it.
With the win, India became number one side in the ICC T20 rankings, overtaking the West Indies in the shortest format. Winning all the three T20 matches. However, the women's cricket team failed to complete the whitewash as they lost to Australia by 15 runs in the third and final women's T20 match. Chasing the victory target of 137 runs, the visitors could only manage 121 runs for 8 wickets in 20 overs. Indian women's team had already grabbed the T20 series, winning first two matches. Bureau report, Rajya Sabha TV.
And some other news from Australia, of course, world number one Novak Djokovic retained the Australian Open men's singles title after beating Britain's Andy Murray in straight sets in the final. The defending champion was at his ruthless best at Rod Laver Arena as he beat Andy Murray 6-1, 7-5, 7-6 in 2 hours and 53 minutes. After being thrashed in the first set, Murray fought hard in the next two but fell short of making a comeback as he was condemned to a fifth final defeat at the Australian Open. With the win, Djokovic equaled Roy Emerson's record of 6 Australian Open singles titles. The Serb also drew level with tennis greats Bjorn Borg and Rod Laver on 11 Grand Slam titles. Djokovic has now won 4 of the last 5 major tournaments, including the last 3 in a row, and will try to complete his career Grand Slam with the first French Open title in June. That's it on this edition of The Breakfast News. Have a good day.